What if you were born just one day later?
Sir, I don't think that would have made a big difference to me.
Actually, that would make your birth date as 3rd of January. Nothing occurs to you?
I'm sorry, sir. I can't think of anything on the 3rd of January.
What if your interview instead of April 12th
yes, sir.
Was on April? Is it 10 or 11? There is some certain historical importance to the date.
So it is a 10th of April.
1 or 2 days before or 1 or 2 days after?
Sorry sir, I can't recall any significant date.
No, is there any historical importance to April 10 or 11?
Sorry, I can't recall.
13.
I'm sorry, sir.
14.
Sir, perhaps if you could point me to the time period, then
any historical importance of April 14th, man. Anybody who forgets April 14th?
Not only then.
Sir, I think America's entry is on the 14th of April.
And 13th also, there is a great importance in modern Indian history.
Sorry sir, I can't recall. I will check it out.
Yeah. What is cloud programming?
Sir, cloud programming is a term that can be used to define programming that we use on a cloud network or a platform which is used on the cloud. Cloud computing is basically a system wherein resources are shared, such as programs, operating systems, various softwares or storage. Such services are stored over the internet from remote locations.
Okay. So, have you used this technique anytime?
Yes, sir. I regularly use cloud computing for a variety of purposes, primarily as storage. A lot of my data I use.
Not for research work?
Sir, I haven't personally programmed on a cloud. I've used it as an end user on cloud services.
Now, in spite of doing your GE computers, which is the in thing today, why do you want to come in for the civil services?
Well sir, I think that this is a occupation, this is a profession that I will enjoy. I think it is the right choice for me, which is why I want to join the civil services instead of continuing with my engineering.
How can you enjoy modern computing when you are, you know, under the thumb of any political leader and you have to be kicked around according to his bills?
Sir, first of all, I don't think it is right to say that civil servants are under the thumb of political leaders. I think it is a more appropriate term would be to say that civil servants and politicians coordinate with each other. But sir, as far as my personal choice goes,
coordinate quid pro quo?
Utopian concepts.
Sir, quid pro quo for the people's welfare.
I think for the people's welfare, but I haven't seen anybody doing that for the people's welfare. Give me one example.
Sir, if I could give you an example from my home city, which is Pune, the municipal ex-municipal commissioner of Pune, Mr. Dr. Nitin Kari, was one such example. He was an excellent IAS officer who performed a lot of activities for the people's welfare. So, sir, I agree that there are cases where the civil service is not working towards the people's welfare, but there are also cases where civil servants are working for the people's welfare.
What is the percentage of the positive side that you are talking about?
Sir, I'm sorry, I can't put it into a precise number as such. So for me, sir, if I may quote,
actually some knowledgeable people have put it, and there are official reports about it. I'm simplifying the question, which I shouldn't be doing really. But there are reports about what is the percentage of deadly honest officers in the service and absolute crooks in the service, and the middle ones called as fence sitters.
I'm sorry, I haven't come across any such report which puts a quantitative figure on the equipment.
You may cut. Okay. What do you like to listen to? What kind of music?
Sir, I actually started off by listening to Bollywood music. At one point of time, I started listening to rock and metal music. By the time I entered college, I had started listening to classical music, Indian Hindustani classical music. And ever since I started listening to classical music, I enjoy it the most. Other forms of music don't appeal to me as much.
You like instrumental more or vocal?
Sir, both actually. It depends on my mood. But I also make it a conscious attempt to ensure that I don't focus on one format specifically. I try to diversify my taste, so I listen to both instrumental as vocal.
Is there any specific instrument of your choice?
Sir, the sitar is an instrument that appeals to me. Primarily because my mother herself is a sitar player, because of which it is this instrument appeals to me a lot.
She performs professionally?
No, sir. Not any longer.
Yes. Yes. And apart from Ravi Shankar,
yes,
who else do you? I'm presuming that sitar people like Ravi
Shankar. Sir, I personally am not a huge fan of Pandit Ravi Shankar, although I enjoy his music as well as his daughter Anushka Shankar. I really enjoy the music.
Anushka Shankar's music you mean?
Yes. Sir, besides that, I also enjoy the music of Ustad Shahid Parvez and Nikhil Banerjee.
And in vocal, who is your favorite?
Sir, my unquestionable favorite is Pandit Bhimsen Joshi.
Somebody living?
Sir, Ustad Rashid Khan, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, there is this discussion about relationship of time of the day with Raga.
Yes, sir.
How valid is it?
Sir, I have a mixed opinion about this. Personally, I do not understand the technicalities of music, but there are certain times of the day when I enjoy a particular rag more. But as far as my favorite rags go, I don't really have a time frame to it. I can sit at any time of the day and listen to my favorite rags.
Sarang at night?
No sir, sarang in the afternoon.
No, I think when you hear sarang at night, you would actually feel bored.
Perhaps actually, sir, sarang is not one of my favorite rags. I don't really enjoy a lot of afternoon rags.
Or darbari now?
Yaman sir,
now.
I would enjoy darbari even right now. I have listened to darbari in the morning, in the afternoon as well, and I have enjoyed it.
It's like people having scotch whiskey in the morning. There is no time limit. That you can have.
I'm not in a position to comment on that.
We are happy about it.
So also Rutus, there is a relationship of Radha with the seasons. How far valid is it?
Sir, if I may put it differently, I think the relation is converse. For example, when I listen to Raag Malhar, I immediately do feel the onset of monsoon. I have had this experience that I am sitting in my room in the dead of the summer at afternoon 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and just listening to Raag Malhar makes me feel better. Sir, although if I may extend this discussion, certain western rock songs also do that to me, that they can transform the weather without it being the actual setting for that particular music.
Favorite rock artists,
sir, again can't really pinpoint a single one, but Metallica, Iron Maiden, Pink Floyd, Led Zeppelin,
all old.
Yes,
not of them. Our generation.
Although ma'am, they are timeless. They are as much as of our generation as much as.
Do you like body here?
Not yet. Sir.
No.
No.
Tell us about this Ink Future. You are a founder or the founder?
Ink Future is a think tank that we have started in Pune. It is a future studies group. It is actually in association with a policy consultancy group based in Berlin, which is known as Collaborative Policy Consultants. The basic idea behind this group is to create a global knowledge network where we would bring in experts from different fields to discuss on issues that are socially relevant. For example, if we were discussing something such as sanitation, then we would normally think that we should bring an engineer to the discussion, a political scientist to the discussion. What we thought of was, what if we bring in a photographer? They would also have a different perspective on this issue, which would be instrumental in solving this issue. So the basic idea behind this group is to bring different people from different disciplines together on one platform, discuss various issues, and have such setups all over the world. Right now we are working in three different locations, which is Pune, New York, and Berlin.
And why this name Ink Future?
So the basic idea behind this is that one idea is that we are going to be thinking about the future, and ink is a subset of the word think. But it is not just as if that we are going to sit and contemplate about it. We also intend to come forth with concrete ideas that we could pass on to agencies that could implement it.
So, we are also going to ink the future.
So, we will try to ink the future, sir.
like somebody inked Kejriwal today in Varanasi.
Sir, yesterday.
That's how?
I'm sorry, sir. Could you please repeat your question?
That's how you are going to ink future.
No, sir.
The way
it's not that way.
How come for IPS you are saying Andhra Pradesh is your first choice?
Sir, actually, IPS is not one of the services that I'm opting for. My choice for IPS is zero. But because there was a glitch on the UPSC website, because of which I had to fill in those options as well. If I had put in zero, it would give me an error. So I had to fill in randomly. So I just filled in 1, 2, 3, 4 in that order.
You don't want to join IPS?
No, sir, not personally. I have enormous respect for the work that the IPS does. I think it is an extremely challenging job. But I don't think that I am personally suited for the IPS.
Are you allowed to write zero there?
Yes, sir. The UPSC form does mention that.
In any case, I should not be considered for IPS.
Yes, sir.
That firm a determination of not wanting to join IPS?
Sir, I think it is better to be crystal clear about my choices rather than some candidates say that they put IPS after the revenue services, which is a de facto implication that they do not want to choose the IPS. I would rather say that I am clear saying that these are the services that I want to join and these are not the services that I want to join.
Many thinkers or historians have said that Indian civilization lacks in historical consciousness. Do you agree?
No, sir, I do not. Sir, my take on it is slightly different. I actually read a very interesting book about this, written by a historian named Sanjeev Sanya. He basically
not a historian.
Sir, the author is Sanjeev Sanya. This basically argues that Indians have had a sense of historical consciousness. We have not always had a sense of chronological consciousness, that our format of writing down history has certain issues to it. But sir, I most definitely do not think that we lack historical consciousness.
You start studying anything in Indian history,
yes,
and paucity of evidences is a permanent problem.
Yes, sir.
How can it happen if that culture had historical consciousness?
Sir, I think the issue is one of having scientific sources of history, such as written documentation. But certain cultures, certain rituals are carried forth throughout the ages. Our folk art, our folk music, the stories that we tell to us, they are also a legitimate source of understanding, recreating history. So that is a tradition which has continued throughout India's 5000-year history. So sir, I think that we do have a sense of historical consciousness.
What is subaltern history?
Sir, subaltern history is the study of history from the perspective of the common man. Instead of focusing on rulers and kings and their wars, it focuses on the state in which the common man was living in during different phases of history.
Why is it called subaltern?
I don't have a very precise answer to this, but the way I understand it is that it is an alternative to the regular study of history, and the main method of focusing, studying history has a lot of different political connotations and dimensions to it. So it is an alternative to this form, which is why I think it is called subaltern history.
Any well-known subaltern historian?
A lot of Marxist historians in India and across the world have contributed to subaltern history. So if I may quote one of my favorite historians, Eric Hobsbawm, has provided a subaltern
history. Hobsbawm is not considered subaltern history. Hobsbawm is mainstream.
Yeah,
in your definition, actually any Marxist interpretation would become subaltern, which is not true.
So then I think I need to revisit my understanding of subaltern history.
Tell us what you like to read.
Well, sir, I like to read a lot of different genres, and I have my favorite authors in each different genre. For example, if I read humor, P.G. Woodhouse would be my favorite author. If I read thrillers, then Alistair MacLean or Dan Brown would be my favorite authors. Also, I don't really enjoy Dan Brown on that much, I guess.
But P.G. Woodhouse and Alistair MacLean are very old, outdated people now.
Sir, old.
I remember reading them when I was in school.
P.G. Woodhouse can continue, but Alistair MacLean is too old.
Ma'am,
and that actually seems to be trained with you.
Everything,
yeah, old, Western rock music, all yes, old bands. In terms of liking music, all old music.
Sir, coming
that
back
is
to
he took company stream?
And yeah.
No, but it doesn't reconcile with Ink Future.
So I think that we need to have a sense of our history while planning for the future, which is why I think I'm attracted.
Okay, you're talking about some written documents in history. What is a bukhar?
Sir, a bukhar is a... I can't put it into precise terms, but it is a description of a particular king and his various activities.
Description of a king?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, I can't put it into very precise terms.
Does it deal with any historical period, the bukhar?
Sir, the most of bukhars that we see are found in medieval India. So, they focus particularly on that period.
If actually somebody doesn't earn from some job,
yes, sir.
Can you say that this is where you are employed? Doesn't employment presuppose some payment?
Sir, I think it is, I personally don't look upon payment only in monetary terms. Payment is something that I get in exchange for the services I provide, and it need not always be in terms of monetary compensations. The sort of experience
is an Indian economist.
Yes, sir.
Is it employment?
Sir, from my point of view, I do consider it to be an employment.
Is you are required to write what? One or two pieces per week?
Sir, one column per week.
So that makes it employment according to you?
Yes, sir. On a part-time basis, but not a regular 5-day-week job, but employment nonetheless.
What is rightist and leftist?
Sir, rightists and leftists are ideological divisions of people. Leftists are basically those set of people who subscribe to Marxist and communist ideologies. Rightists are basically...
Aren't there leftists in US politics?
Yes, sir, there are.
Are they Marxist?
Sir, leftists and rightists have to be interpreted in terms of that particular social setting.
So you said leftist mean socialist or communist or Marxist?
If I may rephrase my earlier answer, there are people who are considered to be leftists in the US.
No, they are leftist. Democratic Party,
yes,
is
sir.
Considered leftist in US politics.
Yes, sir. So on a relative scale, I think that would be a better way of putting
it. When did this originate?
Sir, if I remember correctly, the idea basically started in the British Parliament, where those subscribing to socialist ideologies, people such as Robert Owen, they would be seated on the left-hand side of the British Parliament.
Have you heard of the French Revolution?
Yes, sir.
You want to change your answer?
I can't put a very precise answer to it, sorry.
Would you describe yourself as rightist or leftist?
Sir, I wouldn't describe myself as in either terms. I basically have my own set of values which I subscribe to. They may seem like leftist at certain points of time, rightist at certain points of time. Sir, if I may quote, I recently read this report by McKinsey which described the political leadership of China. And they said that the Chinese leadership, instead of subscribing to any particular ideology, are pragmatic. They see what is the best out, what particular idea would give the best outcome for their people, instead of considering is it a leftist policy or a rightist policy. Sir, I think that I follow that particular idea. I have my own set of values. People may think they are leftists or rightists from there.
So ideology is immaterial as long as you have power, it is.
Sir, people's perception of my ideology is immaterial as long as I can remain true to my own ideology and I'm willing to consider criticism on an objective plane and keep on improving myself.
McKinsey's report about China is misleading.
Sir, I don't know how to comment on
China that. Is firmly committed.
Sir, politically speaking, China does remain a leftist state. But economically, it is the rightist. Sir,
yeah.
If I mean,
still, it is state control. All economy is still state control.
With due respect, sir, I would disagree with it. China does have state-owned corporations functioning within the state, but they also have given a lot of impetus to private industry.
on all private industries, there has to be Communist Party members appointed by the party. And at the end of the day, even that private undertaking has to listen to them.
Sir, I will recheck that and reconsider one more.
Which pragmatism is this?
Sir, I think the pragmatic dimension comes in once we consider what exactly those members of the CPC do in those firms. If their basic function is to increase welfare, increase the efficiency of those private corporations.
Their job is to make that private corporation follow the diktats of the party.
Sir, I am sorry, I need to re-study
this. What happened to Bhoshilai, for example?
Sir, the issue with Bhoshilai was...
And his wife.
Sir, the issue involved was that Bhoshilai's wife was implicated in the murder of a British businessman. Bhoshilai himself was accused on charges of corruption, and which is why he was imprisoned later on. Sir, I think these actions have to be considered irrespective of their own political ideologies. Even if China were not a leftist state or a rightist state or any sort of state, they would still, in my opinion, they should have still done all of those actions on Bhoshilai as well as his
wife. Can I just continue with what sir was saying about China? China is today promoting trade war and currency war.
Yes, sir.
What is this trade war and currency war?
Sir, the basic notion of the Chinese economy, the Chinese economic growth is driven by encouraging exports. And in order to make Chinese exports more competitive in the international market, they are artificially devaluing their own currency so that Chinese goods are more competitive in the global economy. So because of this, they are
artificially devaluing.
Yes, sir.
That's not the word to be used. Devaluation has a very specific meaning in economics. They are artificially keeping the value low.
Yes, sir.
Pegging it.
Sorry, I used the wrong term, but the Chinese currency, if we consider its parity with the dollar, is not at a state that it should be. They have intentionally kept the exchange rate high.
What is currency war?
Sir, currency war, it is actually a book written by this economist named James Rickards. It is basically this idea that the wars that we will see in the future, the geopolitical struggles that we will see in the future, will be conducted along economic lines, and the main driving force of these economic conflicts would be determining the rate of currency exchanges. Hence, this term is known as currency wars.
Why you like to travel?
Ma'am, for me, traveling is a very liberating experience. It exposes me to a lot of different cultures, a lot of different ideas, a lot of different people. And ma'am, on a very personal level, it also gives me time to sit and think of a lot of different things. And one of the things that I enjoy by traveling, especially by train, is reading. So because traveling gives me the opportunity to do all of this, that is the reason I enjoy traveling so much.
What are the particular places that you enjoy the most?
Ma'am, my favorite place is the Himalayas. I have visited the Himalayas on several occasions. I have gone on 3 Himalayan treks as well. I have visited Himachal Pradesh on 2 occasions. I have also had the opportunity to go to Kashmir. Besides this, I have visited different parts of India such as Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh. I went to Gujarat as well, but visited just the city of Ahmedabad. And I have travelled within Maharashtra as well.
Have you observed any parliamentary debate on TV or?
Sir, on TV, yes.
Just before voting, for example?
Yes, sir. On some occasions.
Just when the speaker or the chairman announces a vote is to be taken,
yes,
he or she says, clear the noise.
Yes, sir.
What is the significance of that phrase?
Sir, as per my understanding, clearing the lobbies is basically a call for the MPs to be seated and to use the voting devices and the buttons instead of using a voice vote. This gives a much more accurate picture of what the parliament or the house is voting for.
What is quantitative easing?
Sir, quantitative easing is a policy which was introduced by the US Federal Reserve after the 2008 subprime crisis. 3 stages of this policy have been implemented so far. The basic idea behind quantitative easing is to introduce greater liquidity into the US economy.
You are not telling the meaning. What is quantitative?
Sir, it is a easing of monetary policy in order to introduce greater liquidity into the market.
What do they do?
Sir, they buy US Treasury bonds the Federal Reserve buys US Treasury bonds and introduces currency into the market. In order, this is basically a policy implemented to fight recession.
How did it impact India?
Sir, the basic idea, quantitative easing had an impact on India as well as different economies all across the world. Because there was greater liquidity in the US markets, and at the same time interest rates in the US markets were also, in the US banking system were also reduced. This created a lot of money which did not have places where it could be parked, where it could have higher returns. So a lot of US investors took this extra liquidity, invested it in India because India gave higher rates of returns, and this increased the rupee's strength as compared to the dollar. Today we are in danger of being adversely affected by quantitative easing because the US Federal Reserve is planning a rollback of this process.
Is planning?
Sir, they have started implementing it.
What is DTAT?
Sir, DTAT is Double Taxation Avoidance Treaty.
Sir,
it is basically a bilateral treaty signed between two nations, which ensures that a particular service, for example, investment, is not taxed twice in the country of origin as well as the destination country.
Yeah, this treaty with any
other? Yes, sir. We do have DTATs with a lot of different countries. The most prominent or controversial example of this is Mauritius.
Why is it controversial?
Sir, Mauritius, despite being such a small nation, has the highest source of FDIs into India. This is largely, experts say that this is a sign of black money being laundered and routed via Mauritius into India, which causes a lot of financial threats to the Indian banking, to the Indian economic system.
What is your opinion about opening up the multi-brand retail sector for India?
Sir, I think that it is a positive step which would help India and Indian economy, particularly in areas such as supply chain management. And it would also be beneficial for the farmers within India.
That makes you rightist.
Sir, as I said, I don't really prescribe to any ideological framework. These are my opinions, they may perceive to be rightist.
What is the solution to the Doha debate?
Sir, in my opinion, the Doha debate is not going to be resolved via the WTO. I think it is time that we move from an international organization to a system where we have relations between different nations and solve that debate separately using bilateral mechanisms with different nations.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
All the best.